name is Samrai Dagos. I'm a member of Erico and co-founder. And Erico is a nonprofit organization that is established to connect and collaborate Eritrean pharmacists or pharmacists with Eritrean heritage, and then to also educate the general public. And on that note, today, Dr. Almaz is going to give us a presentation on how hormonal changes over time, and she's going to explain what the changes are and what that means to us. And Dr. Almaz is an expert in hormonal therapies, and she's also a pharmacist. She's going to introduce us to herself and go on with her presentation.
A little bit about me. I am a pharmacist by training as well as an expert in hormone therapies. I own a compounding pharmacy, and that means I do make this hormone therapies, and I educate other patients. But this session is not an advertisement for my business. It is strictly to educate the public and support you with your upcoming journeys, or if you're already there in the menopause, perimenopause, and postmenopause state. And a lot of people did contribute to this presentation. Reviews have happened by many of us in the ERICO group, and I appreciate all the critical views and reviews that I've received to make sure that we're giving you educational and unbiased material. This is me in the picture, and our agenda today, we've gone through the disclosures, and some of this material may not be FDA approved. However, I just want to give you a slight history of what FDA approved means and what it doesn't mean. Actually, we did not get the process of research involvement for women up until 1986, 87. And the first, it was approved into a law in 1993 for women subjects to be part, to take part in studies. So when we say FDA approval, the first conjugated estrogen was approved in 1941, and women just got involved in studies after an issue with a drug that was causing limbic issues for patients in 1977. So it's relative when we say FDA approved. How did you do a study in 1941 on whom to approve estrogen therapy for women? So take that with a grain of salt is all I'm trying to say here. Our agenda for today is how do our hormones adjust as we age? What symptoms and physiological and psychological symptoms we can expect? And what are the other the treatment options that we potentially have at play? So this is just to kind of give you the hormonal pathway. It starts with cholesterol, believe it or not. And then it kind of breaks down to the ones in pink are the typical hormones that we see in female. Progesterone, estrone is, there are three estrogens, estrone, estradiol, and estriol. And we do have testosterone in women as well. So this is just to kind of give you the process, and hormones do affect multiple aspects of our processes. And therefore, it's not limited to our reproductive system only, but cardiovascular as well as our bones and a lot more. So here in this slide, I just kind of want to give you the lay of the land, if you will, in terms of the hormonal decrease. So looking at our early 30s and 20s, we have a full range of hormones that are up in the normal, what we call normal levels. As we hit the mark of like 35 for some, and mainly at about 40 some years old, your hormones kind of start dipping. The progesterones in particular, they go down up to 99% of from where you started to where you are in menopausal stage. The estrogens sometimes could lag, and that is when there is estrogen dominance type of zone, and that causes like endometrial and other issues that we will save for another lecture. However, there are states of there is a need for checking the levels and diagnosing appropriately in terms of which type of menopause are we treating or where are we? Like, is it high? Do you still have high estrogen, but you're having night sweats? Do you want to give a little bit of progesterone initially and then subsequently add the estrogens? Or sometimes it's all of them have diminished enough to where you need to treat with all of them. So what does it mean to be premenopausal or early stage of our lives in our 20s, early 30s? We're perfectly fine. Our cycles are regular at about 28-day mark. We get our periods. And this is like an intricate estrogens and progesterones and our other trigger hormones that are produced in our brain. And the ones that are produced in our ovaries are the estrogens and the progesterones coming into effect. And then we have our regular cycles. In the perimenopausal stage, it starts as early as 35 for some, but most of us will be going through perimenopausal, and yours truly is going through it right now. I'm in my 40s, and that is really where you see the decline in the numbers of hormones, and therefore your cycles might fluctuate. They might start being late and irregular, or sometimes heavy, sometimes very spotty. So, and the night sweats and things start to happen at about 45, and by the time we get to about 50, we are approaching postmenopausal. Where menopause is defined at least 12 months without a period. And that is when your ovaries are saying, I'm retiring. And women on the side in the picture are experiencing, well, claudication, meaning brain fog. You're not remembering as sharply as you used to, or you could feel like you're hit by lightning, a little warm, and you would see body image change, abdominal fat growth, hips kind of expanding beyond what we like normally. And that should be your signs that you are either in menopause or close to it. The different states and different symptoms happen at the different states. So I said the hallmark of perimenopause is the irregularity of your periods. However, fibroids, even if they were small initially, they tend to grow in this stage when your hormones start to decline. Your weight gains, mood swings, and loss of libido is a big issue that is kind of like a taboo to discuss, but we are here to learn, and that is part of the deal that you get with hormonal declines. At about 51 and a half or so, you will hear hot flashes a lot. It is a vasomotor change. When a lot of women might describe it, in Tigrinya in particular, so it's like they're having really hot flashes and their estrogens have tanked and they need to be replaced. The postmenopausal, you could by then lose that hot flash. However, the heart diseases, the vaginal dryness, breast cancer, incontinence, osteoporosis, which is bone loss or decrease in your bone structure, and depression, all of these symptoms continue to happen despite the fact that you may or may not experience hot flashes. I also want to caution that not every woman experiences all the symptoms or the same symptoms. Therefore, just because you didn't experience hot flashes does not mean you will not have cardiovascular risks or heart disease type of risks, or your bones will not be diminishing. It's also the age. Some experience it earlier. I have patients who are currently being treated with hormonal therapies in their late 30s, and some just delay it until they're in their 50s or until they get the hot flashes, the night sweats that they can be really embarrassing. The onset is fast, and you could have like just a bout of sweat while you're working, and those tend to be embarrassing and irritating to a lot of us women. And there is help and there are ways to treat these symptoms. And it's not a taboo. It's going through regular body change and expected to be. So the hormone balance pillars are nutrition. We cannot dismiss nutrition, not just because it is a good thing for our health and our overall well-being, but it also plays in your hormonal balance. The ovaries and there are other glands that are called adrenal glands. These two little glands sit on top of your kidneys, and they can produce estrogens and progesterones, and particularly estrogens kicking in some women. Therefore, those women who got help from their adrenal glands don't experience the symptoms the way some who did not have that adrenal gland producing estrogen as the ovaries retire would have experienced. Detoxing. I know groups and like the women Adde Power. I love the fact that what you guys are doing, trying to sweat and stay healthy. Our kidneys and our gut health is important here because there are hormones in all of these organs. And when those change, things do change for your kidneys and your liver, and upping the detox in your system is always appreciated during that time, if not always. So constipation could be something that you would experience as part of peri or menopausal stage because of estrogens that were in the gut are no longer available. Part of why we get the fat deposits growing is also because of these estrogens that are available and working for us prior to our menopausal age. But as that gets declined, our ovaries and our body, like our uterus, tries to just get whatever estrogen is available in our system and draws them in. And therefore, the less priority areas like our abdominal fat gets depleted even more, and therefore you see the weight gain there. It's real. Stress management is very important as well. And your cortisol, as I showed you in the first few slides, there is cortisol involved in the process of changing hormones because your progesterone does play with your cortisol. And if that system is broken and not managed, your cortisol goes up. And therefore, there are managements that need to be, that could be done to help with that stress management. But yoga and other activities do tend to help. They may not be as effective as hormonal therapies. We will focus on bioidentical hormones a lot in the next few slides because that is the mainstay of therapy for menopause. But I want to spend a lot of time explaining the differences between hormones, bioidentical versus synthetic. You need to advocate for yourself. If nothing else from this lecture, I want you ladies to take at least the self-advocacy for when you need to be treated and what you need to be treated with, bioidentical versus synthetic hormones. So what are those? When we talk about bioidentical, we're talking about the chemical structure of the hormones. Some hormones are different because they are made either from animal urine or just in a lab with incorporating chemicals into the overall structure. And this came about because pharmaceutical companies could not patent natural products. And therefore, they have to chemically tweak them in order to make a synthetic hormone that is FDA approvable. And there is a lot of politics out there. And patenting is a lot of money for everyone involved. And therefore, patent is how they protect the right to sell a specific drug for about 10 years. And therefore, if it is approved as a brand, through the FDA process, it is more lucrative for pharmaceutical companies. Versus natural hormones, the chemical is identified. It is exactly as it comes in our natural bodies. That is what it means by bioidentical, and therefore it should work the same. Think of this as a lock and a key. You might go out there and duplicate your keys, and it could still go into your lock, but it may not unlock your door because of the fact that there is some tweaking that happened to that key that is not as good as the original, and therefore unable to do the function the way it does. And that is why we see a lot more side effects with synthetic hormones versus the bioidentical hormones. They could get in the lock, but if it is the exact same product or structure as the one that you were supposed to have naturally, it is likely to work effectively and not affect other areas because it is the exact same structure. So it really is important that we understand this distinction and the importance of it. So what advantages do you have if you were to buy the off-the-shelf or what is already made in the pharmacy, or I mean, in the manufacturer areas and available at the pharmacy? Those tend to be covered by insurances because insurances will say FDA approved is what we cover, but we will save that discussion for another day. However, it makes them cheaper because they are covered by insurances. Most bioidentical hormones are not covered by insurances because of the fact that it's deemed there are codes in the drugs, and therefore they tend to be cash priced. So I understand, and just there are a few like estrogen is a bioidentical hormone in the off the shelf. Just be picky and know which ones are bioidentical, which ones are not, no matter where you obtain your medications from. Also, in customization, of course, the off-the-shelf are already made for a certain dose. If you need to deviate from that and or you require less or more in a compounded state, you can pretty much elect as to which one you wanted, what dose you wanted made for you. And therefore, it is more customizable at a compounding pharmacy. I hear feedback. Is that a question? So just to understand the chemical structure, I have bit it down, but it's that important. And I want you to really always think about that when you're getting through this process of getting hormones from your OB doctors. If you can afford it, you might want to consider compounded hormones. But we will talk also about compounding pharmacies, how they get their chemicals. The chemicals are FDA approved. It is what, when we say not FDA approved, we're talking about the packaging process. Meaning, when you saw that picture earlier where I was making it, I get the chemicals that you see in the back from an FDA approved manufacturer, but I make the doses specific to the patients because I am able to, I know what creams I need to put them in. And these are formulations that are available. And if you do have the means and are able to get them from a compounded pharmacies, also be selective with what your compound pharmacy looks like. Go in and visit their sites and really don't just rely on everybody's thought. But just to, again, hone on the chemical structures and why the difference and why it matters. This is what you naturally make in your hormonal process. Your ovaries are making progesterones, natural. This is medroxyprogesterone acetate, or what you would find in Provera. Look at all this black chemicals here. These are additions to make this a brand approvable. they are not available here in your natural hormone. That is what I meant by lack and key and the differences here. And we're talking about the same on the ethyl estradiol and all those other chemicals that are used in your combination of birth control pills, as well as the chemicals like the what we call conjugated estrogens. Those are the ones that were approved in 1941 and on prior to women's studies. Bioidentical hormone, on the other hand, looking at the chemical structure, it is identical to what your natural hormone is. So which one do you think will fit in your receptors or the place where these are supposed to act on and have exactly the same impact versus when you have a hormone that is not exactly the same structure? This is a picture of my facility. I just wanted to let you know that the compounding pharmacies are required to build a certain way and meet the standards. However, not all of pharmacies are built the same. So important to know that your medications are made in the appropriate facility. And we're supposed to have the sinks there. We're supposed to have, so this is meeting the requirements. And you could do that. You can look at their pictures, even on their website. Some of the pharmacists will have that information. Now that we talked about hormone therapies, you can get a combination of your testosterone, progesterone, estrogens as part of hormone therapy. However, there is a subset of women who are unable to take estrogens as supplements. And those are those either women who have breast cancer history, and it's not highly recommended, particularly oral route, for women who are smokers. And there might be other issues that I'm not discussing. However, it is important that you know and you make sure that you are a good candidate for hormones. If not, what else can you do? There are some adaptogenic herbal medicines that could help with the stress and the cortisol management, as well as the overall well-being. And there are a variety of them. Be careful, again, what you choose from and who you get it from, because some do sell all kinds of stuff that may or may not be good for you. So be selective with your supplements as well. But there are also other agents, pharmaceutical agents, that are used for other indications like antidepressants, what we call serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or if you have heard of the Prozac type of antidepressants, they could potentially be used for management of menopausal symptoms. Gabapentin was approved for seizures, but there are studies showing that it is effective in managing hot flashes. And there are women, so there is help. There are other modalities besides just hormones, even though hormones are the biggest, because it is, we're trying to talk about depleted tank and refilling. Therefore, hormones will be your main go-to and would alleviate your symptoms the fastest. However, if you're not a good candidate for hormones, oxybutynin also has showed efficacy, or meaning it has mitigated the hot flashes and symptoms of menopause. Plant-based estrogens. Well, there are food types that could really generate this estrogens and do have estrogens, like soy, flaxseed, and many other food types. The issue with that is there is a lot of talk, oh, this is natural and therefore good for you. However, you need to be careful. If you are like breast cancer person or has family history of breast cancer and you take estrogen, it is estrogen still, natural or not. So you should shy away from that. And if you're a person who have had hysterectomy, where you have removed the uterus and the whole idea of giving progesterone is to protect your uterus. If you don't have it, what are we protecting by giving you progesterone? Again, there are some cases where I have patients where I give small dose of, or I recommend a very low dose of progesterone, even if they have hysterectomy, but if they have partial hysterectomy, because progesterone also affects your sleep. And therefore, I want to help them, but at the same time, I don't want to give them hormones that are really not helpful to their overall well-being. So not all natural are good, and not all pharmaceuticals are good. You have to be selective. You have to advocate for yourself and your well-being, and really spend the time discussing with your prescribers or your healthcare professionals, and really reach out also to ERPO. And from time to time, we will go on ahead and update information. And really, we're here for you, as I can speak on behalf of all of my ERPO colleagues. And I think we would love to support you if you need us. And we are always going to throw this type of educational material out there. But Q&As, reach out and get educated. But most importantly, when you visit your doctors, it's not always the best experience in that they may not be trained in all of these aspects. The issue we see, I graduated from School of Pharmacy, one of the top school of pharmacists in the nation, but we only spend a few hours discussing this type of material. Most of us who are really trained and expert in these areas have really gone out and about and learned beyond what our schools have taught us. So a lot of your doctors may not be as supportive of what your hormonal needs are, or they may not even know exactly what to prescribe. And a lot of times there are these individuals, different type of doctorate degree, called naturopathic doctors. They tend to be more trained in this area and understand hormonal change better than your typical OB, or much less also your general physicians. So don't get discouraged. Know that there are other helps. At least be dangerous enough to ask questions. So with that, I think I can open the floor for questions, but if you care to read, these are references that I have put together in here. There are a lot more out there that I study and read and try to kind of glean some good information from, but there are sites called PubMed is a more reputable site where scientific data is published, versus on Google, you might find information that is being generated from people who have no experience or no business posting information on that. So be selective, self-advocate, and learn from those who are in the field or are willing to dig up information on your behalf. With that, I think I will open up the floor for questions.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Almaz. That was very interesting, especially because for me, I'm actually studying menopausal mice right now. I'm doing it more in animals, but this was an interesting thing. I was surprised to see that progesterone drops before estrogen. That was also very interesting. So my question is, actually, when you give these women hormone replacement therapy, do you see a reverse in, say, maybe their obesity? Because, you know, like you mentioned, there's always a weight gain, or some sort of depression, or the other symptoms that come with menopause. Do they experience a reversal of these symptoms after you give them these therapies?
Yeah, absolutely. Their body muscle mass changes, and particularly when there is a decrease in your testosterone. I need to emphasize this again. that women do have testosterone, and when you supplement them with the testosterone and bring the estrogens up to par, then the body shape gets help, and your exercises become more effective, and the body shape gets back to the plump and stage of your life, as opposed to just kind of getting dry. The dry skin, the hair thinning gets reversed, as well as your weight management improves. So I have seen it all.
Okay. Also, just a follow-up question. When there's an imbalance between the progesterone and estrogen, I know that when the progesterone gets low and if the estrogen gets really high, that the women tend to gain more weight, right?
When the estrogen is high?
Yeah, because they're imbalanced, aren't they? Right?
Right, there is imbalance in that. A lot of that, it's not necessarily fat, but also water retention. With estrogen high, it's you retain more water. And not just that, but sorry, go ahead.
No, go ahead. Go ahead, tell me.
Yeah, so there are others, like are they having any other issues, like in the endometrial issues? So you have to really look at everything else, but kind of like the imbalance of either one in terms of your estrogen, your progesterone, and testosterone could manifest in many of this. But high estrogen generally is more of water retention.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I had a question. I dialed in a little late, and so I apologize if you already mentioned this. I know getting a mammogram, pap smear, all those, checkups we learn about, but, you know, hormone and hormone therapy, at least for me, is a new arena. Have you discussed, like, what age, you know, we should be looking into that? And I know you provide services, but for those that are not in your area, who is the specialist that you see? Is it your OB, primary care? Just curious.
It's a combination of all. So first off, to answer your question, how do you start even, or where do you start? Yes, the hormones start to decline for some as early as 35. For others, it's mainly in their early to late 40s. They start declining. Even if when you're having your periods, you're still at a stage where it's declining. So symptom is your biggest guide initially as to when you can and should treat, versus levels. They can, if you catch them at a different stage of your cycle, your levels could look normal, but the hormones are declining and therefore manifesting in the symptoms that unexplained night sweats. There is no viral infection, then what is happening? Your hormones going down. So that's the hallmark and identifying the symptoms that you would focus on. In the case of who do you see, your primary care physician is likely your first step, because you don't go and see your OBs, but if you know your OBGYNs are more trained in this area, and particularly you should visit those. The issue that I see with a lot of my patients who come after visiting an OB is, well, you're still in your cycle and therefore you don't need hormones, but this woman are suffering. The doctors, the type of doctors that seem to be more of an expert in handling this are naturopathic doctors. Did that answer your question?
It does. Thank you so much. And then I did have one more question, if you don't mind. So is the assessment done then through blood work? I know you said the hallmark and the telltale sign is those physical symptoms, but then when you go to get assessed, is it through blood work they determine your levels?
Yes, there are blood work that will help. They're at early stage, they're not as helpful. But also there are saliva tests that you will see your naturopathic doctor doing as well. There are other markers that they look at to assess if this is estrogen issues, but those are only like cash paid labs. So they try to be cautious with expenses, but there are other markers that you can look at as to see like your follicular stimulating hormones like FSH levels will spike as you go through menopause because those are the triggers for your ovaries to produce your progesterones and estrogens, and they're pretty much barking at your ovaries by going up. Those are produced in your brain. And when the ovaries are not responsive, they tend to go up higher because they're naturally you're supposed to trigger and explain to the ovaries to crank up the production of estrogens and progesterones. So things like that that could be looked at before you rely on estrogen levels, because they could look like, and the range, if you know the range of estrogens and progesterone levels, is huge. So until you are tanked and really plummeted extremely, they may not be able to even know that you're in those states where you need to be supplemented with BHRT or bioidentical hormone replacement.
Got it. Okay. Thank you so much. That was helpful.
Absolutely. Anyone else?
I have another question if nobody else wants to ask.
Ask away, Lydia.
Sure. So you mentioned that some women may have, you know, a drop in progesterone and estrogen. Who is it? And you said you formulate the replacement therapy based on that, right? If I'm not mistaken, that's what you said.
Yeah. There are five types of menopausal. I was sparing that type of scientific lecture for a more appropriate setting. But there are like different type of menopause. And when we hear in the general public, you just hear menopause. You don't hear about, is it estrogen dominance or is there a decrease in your just one type of estrogen, the estradiol versus estriol, or is there only an increase in your estrones, which are the dangerous estrogens? Then you focus on detoxing. I don't know if you've heard of the product called DIM. That is to get rid of the estrones, which are the least friendly estrogen in our body. So really you have to tailor it based on where you are and what you're adjusting. So some women just in the early stages in particular, because progesterone goes down fastest, you want to supplement only with progesterone, as opposed to giving them estrogens when they have high estrogen levels. So that is what I was alluding to when I spoke with, depending on what type of menopause they have.
Okay. So in your observation, which drop of a hormone seems to have more symptoms in women?
Estrogen. And next is progesterone, because progesterone can be a little subtle. They lose sleep and the night sweats start, but the more like hot flashes type of symptoms are due to the estrogen. So, and that is what is reported, the vasomotor symptoms versus like the more subtle body mass change that are more attributable to testosterone versus progesterone, where infertility happens sooner because of if you don't support the uterus with enough progesterone, then it's not viable enough to take care of the implanted egg and support the growth of a baby. Therefore, that's when you see also treating with progesterone in the early stages of pregnancy to support the uterus.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So just one final one. I'm sorry. I'm taking over.
Don't be sorry. This is, I'm pretty sure all the ones who are listening are appreciating your questions.
Thanks. So how well do women, not just in the Eritrean community, but how well do you think women know to reach out to these kinds of therapies after they reach menopause or become perimenopausal?
That's an excellent question. Women are 50% of society, and 80% of women experience some level of hormonal decline-related symptoms. And of those, not many, if you look at it from the broader scale of a number, are being treated with hormone therapies. I would say not even 50% of women. And simply because there has been, the reason why I kind of gave that historical background in terms of when research happened, when did we start looking at women's health, is because women's health was not really understood because women were not involved in studies. And therefore, everybody thought this is a process of aging. You're getting old, and hormones were only viewed as a reproductive hormones, and therefore other symptoms were, there were a lot of thoughts where women go crazy when they get older. It's really not something that they studied, and men in their infinite wisdom decided that women should not be part of studies. So I digress here a little bit, but that is part of why you don't see a lot of women being treated. The stigma of, oh, I'm going through menopause, and some women feel like a sense of uselessness. It really should be something that we need to pay attention to and educate, and it's not enough women who are getting the treatment that they deserve. And kind of like we set the expectation that after you're in your 50s, you're going to suffer, instead of really noting that there is help and you should do something about it, instead of just accepting it as a fact of life and move on.
Mm-hmm. Great. Thank you. Thank you so much, Dr. Almaz.
You bet.
Yeah. I have a question.
Yes, Aiko.
Thank you so much for this excellent presentation, Dr. Almaz. My question is specifically with your product. If you can speak about like how it's applied, the product, and where it's applied, a little bit about that.
Yeah, absolutely. There are different ways of applying hormones. The oral route, the pills that you get, are the most dangerous way of applying estrogen. And that is because it interferes with your coagulation system when you administer estrogens orally. So the best route of administration of estrogens and estrogens and testosterone is topical, because for the pharmacists here, they are lipophilic. So they penetrate your dermis and could be picked up with your capillaries very easily. So topical is the best method of applying estrogen and testosterone. Progesterone, on the other hand, the biggest benefit that you get for particularly mitigating the sleep issues is when you apply it orally. So that's the only hormone that is acceptable and best taken orally, but it still can be applied topically as well, because some of my patients don't want to have multiple different products to apply. So we could combine all four in one, and then they apply it topically. Particularly, you want to apply it on your upper arms, on your wrists, or the back of your leg, because that is where the concentration of the capillaries, the small blood vessels, are, and therefore can pick up your hormones. Applying it in a high fat area is not recommended because, like I said, they're lipophilic, meaning they go into fat and they can stay there deposited in your fat longer, as opposed to getting you the help that you need by going into your bloodstream. Some cases for vaginal dryness, I recommend estriol only, not estradiol, because the receptors for estriol are concentrated in your vaginal area And for dryness, we do make them in creams, suppositories, and you can directly apply them to the vaginal area. For sexual enhancements, testosterone could be applied in the surface also. And that is a lot of other components that we hear aside from just like improving your hot flashes and your overall cardiovascular bone health. And you can use this products also to enhance your overall like sexual health. Libido does drop to the floor when your hormones are tarnished. And therefore you need to consider that as the big component of a happy life when you're treating patients. Any other questions? I see a raised hand from an iPhone. Just go on ahead and unmute yourself and speak, because I don't know that I can operate the hand raised. And I know we're coming up on the top of the hour in the last 4 minutes. If nobody has a question, I will kind of go over. I really want you to, one, know to be very inquisitive when you're visiting your doctors and understand the fact that nobody else will advocate for you as much as you will advocate for your own self. Know the fact that there are natural and unnatural hormones, and therefore really speak to your prescribers about the fact that you want them bioidentical hormones, and they have to be the bioidentical only if you wanted the best result, like the lock and key information that we shared. And next, know your where you're getting your drugs from. And again, there are other forms of help. If you have had a hysterectomy, you don't need progesterone. If you have partial hysterectomy, you might need low levels of progesterone. Estrogens are the mainstay for hot flashes. However, if you have breast cancer history, do not get on estrogen. That is contraindicated. And seek for other help with the other modalities that we have covered. And then again, be mindful of your well-being, both psychological, physical, and emotional, your finances, and your overall peace. With that, I'm done.
Hey, Shudan, you can go ahead.
Thank you.
Almaz.
Yeah.
Hey, Almaz. Sorry, I was not sure whether I am online, so that's why, although I raised it. So I want to ask about... I came later. I'm not sure whether you have explained it or not. I want to talk only about hormonal changes that usually that appears, that gives kind of body weakness for men or women, and where that usually age appears, and what could be the best treatment that would be available.
Hormonal decline is not only happening to women. Dr. Salam, were you?
Yeah, I was going to add to his question. Does hormonal change happen to men?
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
of course. And testosterone is the main hormone in men. And testosterone does convert to estradiol. And the main hormone for men, even though it is testosterone, the component of the small amount of estradiol that is in men is responsible for some of the sexual health. So you need to check your hormones for men as well. And the body mass decline happens, and the testicles don't produce any more testosterone, and therefore you see body change in men as well. My focus today would happen to be in female, but that's not to say that we don't have men who are getting hormone replacements in your 50s. Men do get testosterone replacements, some injectables given every other week, or a lot of them do take the gel and apply it as well. Does that answer your question, or?
Yes, it answers in part, but also in younger men, especially for this kind of for sport enhancement, those kind of things people do, and also some not only the at later age, but also they feel maybe some kind of, if it is abnormal, maybe kind of a disease, maybe they feel weakness even earlier than age. That's what the
No, absolutely. It's kind of like it with women, some women start declining at 35. Some men do have early decline as well. And particularly in the fertile age where they need their testosterone to make sure their fertility is there. And there are other treatments that stimulate your testosterone production, because the production is the reason why they're infertile. And growth hormone therapy, or if you have heard of like injectables, you give them 3 times a week to enhance the production of their testosterone. And that is for when they're fertile, you want to help them that way, not just by giving them testosterone, because of the loop, the feedback loop where it will decrease your natural production. So you want to try with infertility type of treatments to give them that production that is declined, but could be stimulated with those injectables. So yes, okay. It happens, and they should be looked at. They should be testing for their free testosterone, not just all testosterone. And you want to keep them at a range of, bodybuilders like to be in the 800 and above to a 1200. That is not recommended, because the cardiovascular risks increase with your testosterone being above 800. So I always try to make sure that my patients, when their labs are reported to me, I don't want them higher than that. You will see them pushing. But for overall health, you don't want to go below 300. If you go below 300, fertility and your overall health suffers.
And one more question also. Sorry if I'm...
Go for it. As long as the Zoom doesn't shut us down, I'm okay. It's a Saturday.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for that. In some women, even at early age, you see some kind of... I'm not sure if it is kind of a hormonal change. That appears adult acne, even in maybe in their 29 or 30, even they have that kind of acne. Is it a hormonal, clearly a hormonal change because of a hormonal imbalance, or what do you think that one?
There are a couple of things. Hormonal high estrogen dominance, even if their progesterone is down, testosterone is down, there is, I was talking about 5 different menopausal states, but they are described based on which hormone is affected. So if you have a patient like who has high levels of estrogen, they could manifest in breakouts, but also very low. So that's why you see this doctors trying to treat with birth control pills for like acne, adult acne. Mainly, some of it is inflammation of the skin. So you have to really focus on detox and overall well-being when you're looking at skin. Liver health is important when you're looking at skin. Detox them and treat them. Because dirty liver really manifests in skin breakouts. So think of fatty liver and detoxing with juices with high kale, high berries, and really the bitter greens are good for you. And it's hard because people want to just apply something in there and on the topical zone to treat the breakout. But really, if you don't take care of the inside, breakouts will continue. So vitamin A also is another.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, that's why vitamin A works, because it's vitamin A related issues. It's not a hormone.
Issue also.
Right.
Okay. All right.
Quick question then regarding the acne. Would that theory then apply even, you know, for teen acne?
Right. When they are going through that, like, high hormonal change, and that is when you see most of the breakouts is, like, the hormone rage, and your body has not adjusted to how to handle your hormones at that stage. So you also would see it more of, like, the teenage acne are hormone-related.
So you wouldn't recommend retinol topical application? And I'm a mother of teen, and I'm in the middle of that. That's why I'm asking.
I particularly, because reproductive age and retinol, as you know, is not the best option. So I would start with clindamycin type of topical applications, and B3s is really effective in treating topical acne with hyaluronic acid. These are all kinds of products that are out there that nobody really looks at that you should focus on prior to retin-A.
Thanks.
And on older people, on the other hand, retin-A or tretinoin rejuvenates your skin, and therefore it is an excellent product to put them on because it preserves the skin's health. And I personally love tretinoin. Not retin A, tretinoin, because that is the activated form of vitamin A. Other questions? I think we made it like a pharmacist's form. The non-pharmacists out there, if you have questions, please do ask. I think, are there things on the chat? Salam, are you monitoring it?
Hi, okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention, I know this today, Dr. Almaz gave this general education, like public education, but if there are people who want to reach out to you who might want to discuss needing some products or anything like that, if you can provide your contact information, so, you know, they can reach out to you.
Yeah, I don't mind. It's more of because I don't want it to, didn't want to make this advertisement for my services, but my pharmacy's name is Cortex RX. It is spelled CORTEXRX.com. If you search that, you can go ahead and find my email address, my phone number for my pharmacy, and a way to reach out to me. So feel free to do so.
And I also want to point out to everyone that this recording will be shared on our platforms, on our YouTube platforms and Facebook. So whatever information that you think you missed out, or if you want to share it with other people, it will be available. We'll share it as soon as possible.
Thank you. If there are no other questions, I think we can adjourn at this point. And thank you for taking your time to attend this lecture.
Yeah, and I just want to take this opportunity to thank you again, Dr. Almaz. And I do see Ada Power and Mahatan in attendance. I just want to say thank you for all that you do. I follow your works, and we all benefit from there, from your work. So thank you. Keep it up.
Thank you. I appreciate.
I think we have a question from Mahatan for all.
Okay.
Yeah, go ahead.
Hello?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Yeah, sorry, I was in between, so I couldn't hear you properly, but thank you for all that you do. It was really an important topic, especially in our community. And I don't know if someone asked it before me, but in partners, it happens when the woman start to change psychologically and behavioral, and most of the time they get divorced because of that. So how do we approach to our partners, especially men? How do we try to make them understand this is a natural thing? And just to make them as a community, how do we approach that our men when we get to that certain age?
Mom, you're ready.
Yeah, I think that is a very valid question. And it is an issue that is not just in the Habesha community, but believe it or not, in the advanced Western world as well. And the fact is, it's really educating and really taking care of yourself, first off, and going through menopause as just another change in life, and ignoring the symptoms will not help anyone. I think once they understand that this is not behavioral issue, but hormonal issue, they tend to understand and really explain the fact that your sexual health has decreased because of your estrogens and testosterone are not up to par, and you need to be treated. And but it starts with really education for both the woman and the man, because if you don't understand your issue, how can you explain it in the first place? And it's just like there is a stigma and fear of like feeling that I'm not as useful, as important as I used to be when I was younger. We need to really throw that idea and start treating this. It's a natural process. Engage them in therapies. Show them some YouTube videos by, there are a lot of doctors out there who have had like lectures that are really good, geared at educating partners. So really advocate for yourself, not just by self-education, but educating and involving your partners into this process.
Thank you, Dr. Almaz. Really appreciate. Thank you.
Yeah, and it goes for the same for them too. They, I mean, they go through testosterone decline, and there is shame of not being able to perform. It really is. They need to be helped and as well. So, help your men help themselves by dispelling the stigma.
Yeah, you're right. I think as a community as well, I think we need to have like a group that would like a safe space where we can talk about menopause between men and women. I think our understanding as a community is even a little of, as menstruation, we don't have the understanding. So going to menopause, I think is coming a bit frustrating in relationships. So just an idea, I think, with all the experts that we have, that to have that they can, you know, ask their own with their own language, speak with their own people, having that group, I think, if the Erchan pharmacy professionals, if they can do that as well, just an idea that came to my mind, because the barrier is the language as well, especially in diaspora, people really have that barrier not to speak to their doctors, not try to explain in a proper, an appropriate way. So if we can have that space, I think people will have that freedom to speak up and have that more understanding as well.
Yeah, completely agree. And I know Heikel is sitting there thinking of what she asked me to do. She was like hoping that I would do this in Tigrinya, I'm pretty sure. But Heikel, you know, the limitations there. I will have to prepare it and really speak to it intelligently in Tigrinya with the help of my team. And I'm pretty sure Aman and the rest will contribute to the translation so I don't butcher it, if you will. But we'll definitely take those into considerations and develop videos to really educate our people in our own native language. But then again, I don't know if Tigrinya, even though the majority is Tigrinya, we hopefully could develop translators to where we could apply it to our other 9 languages. That would be a wishful and hopeful process, I guess.
Yes, that would be great.
slowly but surely.
What was that, Heiko?
I said slowly but surely. We will start and eventually we will get there.
Yeah, I completely agree. And that's what platforms like Aripco, Matzen, and the Ade Power, Salam Toflo, I see you there. These are great. I couldn't be happier to see this type of programs out there. And it's our duty and our obligation to really get on and put the education in the language that our public can understand. Okay, I think we have compensated for the late start, and therefore the time when was good for the 1 hour. So we're free to drop off, I think.
Yes, we are. Thank you, everyone, for coming, and I hope to see you in our next seminars and webinars.
Yeah, and spread the word. Tell your colleagues and your friends and families that there are programs that are coming up, and if they knew, they might have joined. So please do so for next ERICO programs.